Bible family. It's so great to be with you. It really is an honor and a privilege. I never forget where I came from. I want to just say a couple of thank yous, heartfelt thank yous. I'm really grateful and humbled to be here because I'm nobody. And there's a church in this tribe that had a heart and a vision for reaching young people on the foothill of Los Angeles. It was a pastor, Pastor Paul Plummer. We used to call him Triple P. God gave me a gift in having him be my first pastor. He's just an amazing man. That empowered the leaders of that church to go reach young people, to rescue them. And as my youth pastor told me, he said, "We snatched you out of the fire because I was just a lost person growing up here in Los Angeles. I was either going to end up in jail, OD'd, or dead." And God got a hold of me in the nick of time. And so I'm forever grateful for that church and you as a church family. And Chris knows that whenever I could just be a part of the life that you guys have together, it's just always been a blessing. I want to just speak over you a blessing of grace and peace and hope and faith and love in Jesus Christ. May you be all that God has called you to be. We serve an amazing God who is sovereign, a mysterious God who is worthy of our praise and our awe. I'm okay with the mystery. I don't need to know everything. Kind of bugs my wife because she's a planner. But I'm okay with the mystery. I'm okay. I'm okay with seeing in part because it drives me to my knees further and further to hear what God is saying, to discern what he's doing. And so we're here together to talk about mission and being beyond ourselves. I've been tasked with talking about what it means to be beyond ourselves, beyond our ministry, and also beyond our own tribe. And I believe that the scriptures admonish us, inspire us, instruct us to be kingdom people. And I want to talk about the tension of following Jesus in mission as the Spirit leads us and still remaining loyal to our tribe. What if we partner together? What if we partner together to plant churches? What if we partner together to develop healthy leaders? What if we partner together in whatever God is calling us to do? I want to talk about that a little bit. What if by investing our own time and energy in a collaborative effort, a collaborative mission, it became the very thing that was catalytic in our own life towards experiencing a renewal within our own self and within our ministry? What if you are the missing part, the answer to the prayers that are being offered up right now by others who need resource and your wisdom and your leadership? Now, here's what's true about collaborative ventures and being beyond ourselves. You will almost always not get the credit you deserve. Because it's not you, it's the we. And this is countercultural because we live in a me culture. We live in a culture that says you are the center of the universe, not God. And everything revolves around you. Fame is more important than faithfulness to Jesus, even in the church. We're reminded, when we really think about it, that it's always been about the glory of Jesus and not our own. And so a miracle starts with something you can do and ends up being only something God can accomplish. Let me say that again. A miracle starts with something you can do and ends up being only something God can accomplish. So what if the collaboration is the miracle itself? To get a bunch of pastors who are so independently minded to do something together. What if the collaboration is the miracle? Us working together faithfully to accomplish something big that's larger than our world, where no one can get the credit. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for this time. Lord, I just want to just speak your words to myself first and to my brothers and sisters that are here. We're open. We're hungry, God. We really do want to be in stride, to be led by your Spirit in these days, which are different than the days from the past. So may we be open to all that you're doing in us today. Now, allow me to segue into just a theological track. I'm just going to run through a couple of things that kind of set some kind of buffers for us in this conversation. I want to do due diligence with Scripture. But I'm going to run through them really quickly because I know most of you are familiar with these verses, but I think it's important for me to frame this idea of being beyond ourselves. First, I want to look at John chapter 20, verse 21. Jesus, after he was raised from the dead, comes back to his disciples and he says this. I think this is such an important verse in my life and I believe for the church. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And with that, he breathed on them the Holy Spirit, received the Holy Spirit. This is what missiologists call the Trinitarian dance that we enter into. Jesus is defining that he's the Father's initiative, his calling. He's defining how he led ministry, whose mission it was. And then he also breathes the Holy Spirit on the disciples, essentially to say, you can't get it done on your own, so I'm going to give you the Holy Spirit. He's going to lead you into carry on my ministry and mission. So bear with me again. This is really important that we say it, kind of set a little foundation for this. I wrote this because it just helps me to kind of frame this, because I believe what I'm going to talk about needs to be a conviction and a belief that we have, that we have to flesh it out. And so in regard to this passage, I wrote this. The Father initiates mission to redeem humans, his imago Dei, because he is love. He compels the sending of his son Jesus, the Lord, to invade our time and space, to not only make a way for humans to flourish once again in union with God, but Jesus' incarnational ways informs how the mission of God is to be lived out by his disciples in the world. The missionary Holy Spirit leads the church outward to carry on the ministry and mission of Jesus. As the Spirit-empowered church, we're Pentecostals in this room, right? Our activity and mission is carried out within the communal nature of the kingdom. Therefore, making a multiplicity of partnerships necessary for the reality of the church. Let's look at another verse to just kind of, again, lay this foundation. You're familiar with Ephesians chapter 4. It talks about we're all one body, one spirit, just as we're called to one hope. There's one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all. And then the Apostle Paul talks about how there's grace that's given as Christ apportioned it for our lives. There's been grace given to us. But then he says that there is a maturation that needs to take place in the body of Christ. And he defines that as displayed, the maturity displayed in our unity of the faith, leading to the fullness of the understanding of Christ. So we're all in this together. We're family. Yeah, I was introduced as a Foursquare pastor, but look, I'm committed. I play my part, but I also recognize that my part has a place as an example here with you today, and that's just as important to me. So Charles Van Engen, missiologist, theologian, when he explains Ephesians chapter 4, this is what he says, and I like this. Because our oneness is grounded in Jesus Christ and not in corporate, organizational, administrative, financial structure, or historical unity, we're called to partner together for world evangelism, serving one another in love and humility as we participate in Christ's mission, offering to one another the unique gifts God has given by the Holy Spirit to various organizations and churches regionally and globally until we are all grow up together into the full measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. One more verse, and then I'm going to share a couple of things with you. We get to Acts chapter 2, and we're at Pentecost. The Spirit is poured out upon those who are there. Who is there? It says in verse 5, God-fearing Jews of every nation under heaven. And then it goes on, they go on to describe all the different languages that the people are speaking from the various places they came from. I'm not going to read them all for sake of time. They thought they were drunk, right? You know that part of the scripture too, the people watching. People that drink always get a bad rap. I don't know what the deal is, but... But I want to say one thing about this before we kind of move into more of the practical on this. One of the chief things that happens in the outpouring of the Spirit at Pentecost was that in a world of divisions and hostility, the Spirit drives the church to bridge divisions of race, culture, religion, clean and unclean, and classes, to bless all kinds of people with the goodness of the new kingdom and to welcome them in joining. Don't miss this. Pentecost, for those of us that read Duffield's book, and if you've not read Duffield's book, I don't know what you've read, but for those of us that have gone to EBC or another Pentecostal school, Pentecost is about power. You shall receive power. John describes the Holy Spirit as the Spirit of love. Power without love is what? It's dangerous, too. And love is the benevolent side that God wants us to display. We cannot talk about partnership without understanding the Spirit of love and how benevolent the Spirit is. But there's a joining that's taking place. All the different languages, all the different Jews, God-fearing Jews from all the different places, is the beginning of showing that there's a joining that God is initiating. The kingdom of God is about to receive all different kinds of people. Two things I want to say about the book of Acts. The Holy Spirit is transforming the church by enlarging the church's heart for people that we don't think God cares about. When you read the book of Acts, that's what it's about. The very early on in the church, there's a persecution. And I don't know what you believe about persecution, but it's actually good news in the book of Acts because it scatters everybody to actually fulfill the joining of all these different people that back then they thought God didn't give a rip about. Gender, race, generation, socioeconomic classes, the have-nots and the least likely are joining the family of God. Philip goes to Samaria. What's that all about? Half-breeds are joining. The Ethiopian eunuch, the inclusion and embrace of this high-ranking African official cuts across the racial, socioeconomic, and political lines. But there's also the fact that he's a eunuch. Deuteronomy 23:1, emasculated by crushing your mutilation, shall not enter the assembly of the Lord. And here he is coming in. The marginalized are joining as well. Paul of Tarsus, aggressive and violent enemy to Christians and to Christ, he joins. No one touched him. God had to touch him to get him in. Peter crosses the threshold of Cornelius' house. The Gentiles are joining. Why is this important? Because God is a God of joining, not only in people coming in, but in our lives together. We are to be joining. Now, one of the things that happens to Peter that I love, when he crosses the threshold of Cornelius' house, in a nutshell, he says this: I used to think this way. What just happened in my world as a Jew should have never happened, and that is that the Spirit went before us and was already at work in Cornelius' household. I used to think this way, but now I realize something that I didn't see. And this is my prayer. God, if you need to give me a lobotomy, then do it. But I want to see what you see. I want to change. Oh, there's that word that's so scary to all of us. Change. So let the Spirit enlarge our imagination. God is demanding more of those who already believe. Now let's move to application. Being beyond yourself, being beyond your ministry, being beyond your own tribe necessitates a larger vision of joining. That's the first point I want to make. In this Pentecost chapter, we see the Holy Spirit carrying on vision, mission, and ministry of Jesus. The church is a Spirit-baptized church with an openness to the outsider. This is carrying on the ministry of Jesus. Being beyond is characterized by being open and welcoming to others, just as Jesus did. Jesus was genuinely, listen, this is so important. Jesus was genuinely, authentically, naturally interested in people. We have to be honest with ourselves. Like, I just re-entered the pastorate again. People I'd never met, they needed a pastor, and God had an assignment for me. I'm so thankful for that. But the first thing I had to do was pray to the Lord, give me a genuine interest for these people. Help me to love them well. It's natural for a human organization to begin as a movement coming into existence to further a cause outside of itself. But most eventually, they become tribes, existing mainly to serve themselves and the interests of their members. A kingdom gospel perspective has a built-in resistance to this natural tendency. The more isolated you become as a movement, the more you cease to really be led by the Spirit. Because God is about joining. Until we see a larger picture of who is joining, who God wants to be joining, we will never have the need to see beyond ourselves, to see beyond our ministry, to see beyond our tribe. The larger vision we have, an imagination of what God is doing in the world, necessitates, leads us, propels us to have a larger vision. There's some things you can do, and you do really well. But the larger vision of people joining the family of God will always require for us to partner to see a great harvest in these days. You know, for years, Chris and I have trained church planters, and I've always wanted them to know and to embody this kind of humility, that when they showed up to plant in whatever city that God was calling them, that they would understand that before they got there, the Holy Spirit was ahead of them. The Holy Spirit was already at work in forming other communities of faith that existed before they did. So show up humbly. Because you fit into the mosaic of this one body. And they have a part. If you'll open up yourself and be vulnerable, they have a part in actually helping you, giving you intel, helping you to know the land. The pastors that did that did well. We are not autonomous. Autonomy does not exist in the kingdom of God. The way of Jesus, the kingdom culture and ethic is built in this countercultural reality of being interconnected and interdependent. Let me declare, I need you. I need every one of you. I have some great friends, brothers and sisters in this room who have been a part of my journey, and I've needed you every step of the way, even though we've been a part of different tribes. The devil is atomizing us, fragmenting and dividing us. Radical independence is his poison. Self-focus, me first, my way, or get out of the way, is this self-idolatry. It is the reigning idolatry of the devil unleashed in the world today to manifest itself even in our churches. And this is what we see in the news every day, is this kind of multiplication of radical independence, this autonomous way of living. Can we get over the Reformation mentality? Let's be less militant, less sectarian, less reactive, and less independent. Now listen, I'm well aware that what I'm saying has a potential danger, and so let me put you at ease here. This vision of joining that I'm painting is not proposing a homogenized community where people lose their distinction, ethnicity, culture, or history to an already existing dominant culture. We are called to live with simultaneous union and distinction, and to hold that tension in balance, where everybody gets to live out the preferred future that God has given them in the fullness of who they are. Their distinction matters, but not over someone else's. We can live in this simultaneous union and distinction. I remember, I was reminiscing about those early years when I came to Christ, maybe a believer, trying to figure out the timeline. Within 6 months of giving my life to Christ at the Open Bible Church in Tujunga, I was invited to speak at a youth group at a Southern Baptist church in Pacoima. My best friend was the PK, a Southern Baptist PK. He was a lifesaver for me. I didn't know what the theological differences were. All I knew is Jesus loved me and forgave my sin, and I gave my life to him. I didn't know what was taboo or any of that stuff. So I'm sharing my faith at this Southern Baptist church. And the youth pastor then shows up at what we called our Thursday night youth meeting powerhouse with his youth group. And he just brought the whole youth group. Why? Because there was a revival taking place there. And he wanted to just catch the embers of it. So he showed up. He brought his whole youth group. I think he came like twice. I was trying to figure out how many times he came. They were hungry to catch the fire. There was God. God was doing something in that church, and that youth pastor knew it from the Southern Baptist church. He shows up there until the parents had a fit and stopped his joining. It's an unfortunate reality. I'm not saying that they couldn't be Baptists anymore. I'm just saying, I think the heart was saying, I want these young kids to experience all that the Spirit has, but the parents stopped the joining. And that's in my formation. That always bothered me. Russ Campbell, this PK, he's still my friend to this day. He's an intercessor. And that's his ministry in my life, is he just... I'm always shooting him prayer requests. He attends an Assemblies of God church in near Seattle. Because you just need to go where Jesus is calling you. Being beyond necessitates a learning posture as well. Stay curious. Jesus as a tweener, so he's 12 years old, so he's not 13, but he's not really a kid. He's 12. That's the tweener age. He goes to the temple and he's listening to the teachers and asking them questions. Jesus was asking questions. It's biblical to ask people questions. Jesus was asking questions. Now, the interesting thing about the passage is it says that they were amazed at his answers, but that's Jesus, right? But it's okay for you and I to ask questions. Remain with a posture of learning. Can we all agree that to be a disciple is a lifelong learner? God's not done. Stay genuinely interested in learning. Help yourself out. Listen, help yourself out. I want to shorten my learning curve right now. I'm doing something that I said I would never do, and that's always a problem, right? So church planters would always ask me, well, would you plant the church again, or would you take a restart? When I was doing their assessments, they kind of wanted to know what I thought about that. And I said, no, I would plant the church again, because then I gave them all my reasons why, and I gave them all my reasons why I wouldn't want to restart a church that had an existing culture. And that's what I'm doing now. I'm restarting a church. And I need all the help I can get. I want to shorten my learning curve. And so I need help. And so I'm asking help. Most of my mentors right now are 15 years younger than me. Because the guys that have gone ahead of me and the guys and the gals that have gone ahead of me, I'm not interested in what they think. Because I know what I need right now are the intuitions and sensibilities of that generation to restart the life cycle of my church. And I also want to validate them. I believe that the Spirit of God speaks to people younger than me. Do you believe that? And do you believe that God will speak to them before he speaks to you? So let's validate that and ask them for help. I have a hard rule right now. I don't know if I'll break this rule, but someone asked me the other day, who are you going to hire? And I said, well, I'll tell you this. I'm the oldest person that's going to be on staff. Everybody's got to be younger than me. And I'm hoping in this restart that it can be an apprenticeship model of pastoring so that the next generation can learn from all my dumb mistakes and some of my successes. But I also need them there in my life to really get on with what God wants to do. I believe that. And so life is about learning. Get exponential with your learning. Look, I believe your story is valuable. You've been on a journey. You've been running the race. And when I see people and I talk to them, I want to know their story. What am I doing? I want to make my learning exponential. I'm kind of stealing from them the nuggets and the life that they've lived so that I'm all that God has called me to be. A few years back, I wanted to know what movement making was all about. And I shadowed a guy named John Tyson in New York City. And the reason why it was significant was because I heard that people were willing to pay 20% of their tithable income to join this network. Do you hear what I said? And I was like, what's the deal? That's a lot of money. And so I went there to see what the whole thing was about. I learned so much. And then unexpectedly, they learned some things from me. I remember they were Reformed at the time, independent, kind of Reformed-rooted church, and they were quoting John Wimber at a church service that I went to. And I was with another friend, colleague of mine who'd been a pastor during the Jesus movement, and we were kind of blown away by that because they were beginning to dabble in what you and I have already lived in and seen, right? Shepherding the gifts of the Spirit in the life of the church. And they didn't know what they were doing. And so I'm there to learn from them, but John comes to me and he's like, dude, will you kind of father us in this? Because you guys have been doing this, right? And that kind of learning thing is so beautiful. I got to tell you this because I really want to humble myself. I was really in a crisis of faith, not like a crisis of faith, like I don't believe in Jesus, but just had a real dry place in my life. And I had a trip lined up to go to the UK to study and shadow the Holy Trinity Brompton Church. It's an Anglican church, the Church of England, because this is the church that the Alpha Movement came out of, which has had tremendous impact in evangelism throughout the world. What I discovered there was that there's more intercessory prayer groups than there are alpha groups. Did you know that? That's why it works there. So we just want to plug and play, but we don't want to do the behind-the-scenes work. Come on. And that wrecked me. That wrecked me. Because what I did was I walked into a revival of prayer that was leading to all these salvations. The other thing I discovered was Alpha was never intended to be local. It was a strategy that they discerned to actually see the nation come to Christ. So it wasn't a world vision, it was a universe vision. And I would have never learned that had I not asked, what is going on here? So be a learner. Get over your insecurities. Get over your pride. Being a good partner requires good relationships and being vulnerable. But I have to say this, and I say this again very carefully. Our Pentecostal anti-intellectual roots have really limited us in terms of being inquisitive. We need to be more inquisitive. And what I've heard from young people, so I'm going to say this, I'm not saying that any of you have said this, but I've heard young Pentecostals say to me, I don't feel prepared enough in my studies and my theological training to run in the circles of other movements. And there's a little, so what they're saying is, I'm a little insecure about it. The other thing that has gotten in the way of our Pentecostal movement is our holiness roots. We have a weakness that manifests itself in unhealthy anxiety and fear of getting contaminated by the world. And therefore, we tend to be extractional, remove ourselves from culture and from learning. I say this respectfully, like I'm all in, right? You know, like I'm a Pentecostal, like to the core. But I've seen these things and it inhibits our learning. Not with everybody, but some. Lastly, being beyond necessitates servant partnerships for the harvest field of our time. And I just want to say this and in conclusion. Most denominations set up some type of life-giving structure around regions or districts or areas, I don't know how you call it, but a grouping of pastors. And most denominations have maybe not the same exact language, but it's the intention that those pastors within a geographical area provide care for one another, that they connect with one another in fellowship, right? Does it sound familiar a little bit? And that there's coaching, that there's learning and helping one another. What I tried to do when I was supervising was to add a fourth C, and that was, if we can get our pastors to care, to connect, and to coach one another, but if we can move them to collaboration, we would have a different movement. But what I found was collaborative capacity was lacking. It's actually a capacity. You have to nurture the capacity in your life. I don't want to take away from what your primary assignment is, which is pastor your church. But what I am saying today is recognize that in the joining, the Spirit of God is going to give us perhaps an assignment where we get to partner, we get to collaborate with people to get some things done, like what Chris was talking about, church planting, leadership development, reaching young people, all the things that you want to do together. And remember that some of the greatest gifts you'll receive are outside of your movement in other tributaries that you get to bring back. Let's pray together. As we stand, I'm going to conclude. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, that we're not alone in this race. So shift our focus from growth to a focus on mission. Shift our focus on control to a focus on trust. Shift our focus on ourselves to a focus on others. Shift the focus on garnering resources to a focus on shared resources. Shift the focus on my world vision to having a larger universe vision of seeing a massive joining, a great harvest that's coming in. And Lord, may we be the net together that when Jesus, you told Peter to drop the net on the other side of the boat, the catch was so great that he called his other partners. What an amazing thing. That in the very beginning of his calling, he is already experiencing living beyond himself when he has to call the other boat to come and help. And Lord, may we be interconnected and interdependent and be the nets together that bring in the harvest. In Jesus' name, amen.